I guess the best place to start is the beginning, always. So basically, at the console as you see it now, and you probably can't see it very well, but perhaps Craig can switch views. It's going to come up. It's going to remember where it was the last time it was on, which is both wonderful and maybe not. So I'm going to show you how to get to where you need to be, no matter what it decides it wants to do. And you do that by going to, are you ready? Awesome. Awesome. All right. So we go to scenes. This little button right here, it's about to light up. You can see that the screen has changed. 7 and 8 are the two magic numbers that we're going to be dealing with. Right now it's in MS Morning Song, TC Setup. And there are some super secret, super special things that are in there that I know about that I would not want to put upon you, because they could easily get you if you're not ready for them. So we have made a Morning Song layperson patch, and we are about to go there now. So whenever you see a yellow highlighted scene, that is the one it's in. You also see a small blue triangle there. That's letting you know that that is active and playing. So we're going to go down to Morning Song layperson. It's high lit at the moment. I hope that's the correct tense there. We're going to press go. Now, it instantly has changed. It's right where you need it to be. So that's the first hurdle. So the next thing we need to do is to get back on a screen we can use. We get out of scenes and go back to processing, the very bottom button. That's the one that the console stays on pretty much all the time. Now, you'll see this DLive advertisement here. if you press or select any key, we'll press Landon's channel here, it will go to this screen. You'll see EQ. You can take a look at various different things. You'll actually see that screen first, and then you'll go through the various things going on with the channel, overviews and filters and EQs and insert points, compressors, and all the wonderful stuff that this machine can do. Fortunately, all that work has been done for the most part, and we can just make things loud and make them soft in an artistic manner. All right. So we are on the first layer of the console, which is having to do with the band. Everything on this layer, this group of faders, will be band centric. You have piano, electric guitar, bass C, which is Cooper Cecil's bass channel. Mm-hmm. Two keyboards, 1 and 2, acoustic guitar, drums, bass J, bass for Jeff. Then you'll have Rafe, Lisa, Leah, and Landon. And this is pretty much remain constant. There are a few other things to ride herd over, but this is the basic setup for Morning Song Band. Of course, you'll probably be starting with ministerial staff. And that's where things can get kind of interesting. I'll show you a little bit about that in just a second. But I believe on Bank B, that's where we need to go for ministerial staff. Leslie, Joanne, Robert, Tom, video is stuck in here. Craig is here. Holly is here. And a random wireless 8 for our guest readers. All on the second bank, Bank B.
Oh.
Everybody okay so far?
Yep.
Right here is ministerial. The top bank is the band.
Band, okay.
Now there's some other weirdo crazy things on some of these other buttons, and it's totally fine to press them. It's not going to change anything on you if you press them. So a lot of folks that are new to digital consoles think that, you know, as soon as those buttons go away, something happened and it's bad. That's not the case.
Oh, okay.
It is keeping track of everything, because in many ways, at least speaking for myself, this machine is smarter than me. So, basically, we're pretty much ready to start running audio. In Morning Song, you'll have a rehearsal period when the band is getting warmed up. they're running through and smoothing out any rough areas in the bits and pieces that they're going to be playing. It's perfect opportunity for you to do exactly the same, to sort of familiarize yourself with the material that'll be going on, take a look at the bulletin, get the order under your hand, make sure you know how things are going to flow, and you won't have to do any snap judgment calls. You'll already have it anticipated. All right.
While we're on this speaker layer, if they're hearing a hum come through the speakers, mm-hmm. what instrument is that probably coming from?
When you first turn the console on, if you're conscientious, like I am 50% of the time, maybe, you will beat the band. And when you turn the console on, everything will be unmuted, as you see here. And more than likely, the drums will not be turned on. And through the console, you will get a fairly loud 60 cycle hum. So if you want that to go away, you simply mute the channel and it will go away.
So. And that applies if you're on a Wednesday night or something and you come in here,
yep.
and just need to turn on a couple of mics. If you hear that hum, just mute those drums.
Absolutely. And you know, and if you are in that situation and you're not going to be dealing with the band, just go ahead and mute all of them. Just go through the whole thing, get it out of the way. There's no doubt that everything is muted pertaining to the band. And then you can zip over into your second tier, which is B on bank one. Then you've got your standard microphones that you would be dealing with in, you know, an after hours, Wednesdays at first kind of situation. Leaving the specialized portion of the band thing completely off the slate and out of sight and out of mind, hopefully. Mm. All right. So we're doing okay so far? All is well. I know that, Tom, this is old hat to you in a lot of ways.
Somewhat.
All right. So let's see. We've gone through the various different layers to where you can get to your ministerial staff. And it, like I say, it's perfectly fine to switch between them. It's lightning fast. And I do it every time I use this console, pretty much the entire time. If we want to shift our view over here, this is the master section, although in this console, it can be anything you really want it to be, but master section it shall be for today. You have your main volume slider here or fader here. Next door to that, you have ambient microphone volume, which is kind of strange that it's there, but we'll go with that. Then you have the real important one, lit cyan blue, L-stream, live stream. All right. And even though hopefully soon we will all be together, we will still be streaming. And it's still quite important. My views on it have shifted a lot. And I really view it as important as the service going on in the room, because we can really reach a lot of folks that just can't make it that day. It's a pretty serious job. Okay, so during the rehearsal period, you'll be setting your levels up for the room volume, making yourself comfortable, getting the console under your hand. But there's another mix that we have to worry about, and that is that streaming mix, as I mentioned just a bit ago. On this console and almost all consoles, you'll see this button here that says PAFL. That is pre-fader level. Now they have a specific word that they're attaching to the A, but for our purposes, this is pre-fader level. In other words, this is what you are monitoring with your headphones. If you want to listen to the main mix through your headphones, for some reason, you simply push that button underneath the main mix, and that's what you will hear. Now, this is really handy specifically for live streaming because that mix is subtly different than the one that's going on in the room. And there's a lots of reasons for that, but suffice it to say, this room affects what we hear, and this console is set up to emphasize or de-emphasize part of that effect. Now, when we stream out into the world, of course, this room doesn't exist anymore, and that's not a consideration. So the mix is subtly different between the two of them, but not a whole lot. So let's take a look at what happens on the live stream mix. We have to talk about one more button before we do that. You'll see here in the main mix, we have a blue button there, and it is actually called mix. That allows you to change things specific to where that signal is going. So in the case of the live stream, if I needed to turn up keyboards, I wouldn't turn them up here because I'd be turning them up in the room.
Oh yeah.
I would need to go to the live stream and select mix. And you'll see that a few things have changed over here. We can just toggle between them like so.
Oh, yeah.
So now we are mixing for the audience on the web. And as you can see, it's fairly close.
Yeah, but a little different, yeah.
But just a little bit different. Now, I guess it would, you could approach this like me, which is probably not a very good idea, and constantly toggle between the two of them, because I'm a bit of a control freak. And I want to make sure that that streaming mix is as good as it possibly can be, probably more so than I probably should. But I believe that putting on a headphone set, making sure everything is coming through while the band first starts in this mode, in the live stream, that will be fine for your streaming mix for the band. You can take your phones off, sit them in the basket here, and worry about the room. And the way this console is set up right now, if you turned something down, say for instance, we wanted to turn those keyboards down, you would be turning them down in the live mix as well, or in the streaming mix as well. We have the console set up to where it sort of minimizes you having to toggle back and forth as much as we can. This making any sense? I hope so. All right. So we've got two mixes that are going on simultaneously. We can monitor them all with our headphones. All we have to do is press the button beneath the item we want to hear. Now, we've talked about monitoring the main mix and the live stream. You can also hear exactly what keyboard 2 sounds like, or keyboard 1, or Rafe, or Lisa, if you wanted to do so. It's very handy. Lots of times, especially this time of year, singers are affected by colds and the weather and just the sniffles. And sometimes you need to zone in on one particular singer to see what kind of trouble he or she may be having. And you can give them the necessary boost that they need to make it more like how they were before they got the sniffles. So that's kind of handy to be able to do. All right. All right. So we've gone through all of the band stuff. We've muted things. We've talked about how to monitor the various different signals going out and how to select those mixes. Let's see. Where shall we go from here? Any questions you guys have? Anything that you're unclear on, maybe from months past or the past 5 seconds?
If the band is generally too loud and somebody complains,
yes,
can you just lower the whole shebang band, make it not as loud?
You could do that. You could reach over here and grab all these faders like an old hand concert mixing sound engineer, or you could use one of the two faders we've got right here that have made it very, very easy. These are called DCAs. Okay. There's one marked band and one marked vocals. These are like a break on the band instruments and the vocals. So if the band is just too loud and you can't clearly hear the vocals, but it's plenty loud in the room, you can reach over and take the band down with one fader without touching your mix, without having to do finger gymnastics to cover all those different sliders. Okay. And that is extremely handy, I think.
The flip side of that is that if that's turned down, no matter what you do elsewhere, it won't come up. And that's bitten me once or twice.
It has bitten me too. And so if it bites you, don't feel bad. You're in pretty good company. And we'll get through this together. So right now I've got the console set with the DCA all the way down. and the band is on. And if they were here and they were playing, all these lovely lights would be lighting up, yet nothing would be coming through.
Right.
And at that point, we should panic. No. We should just look at the DCAs and make sure they are where they need to be. And another potential error is if you mute that, as you can see, these lights over here have muted all the instruments in our band patch.
Oh.
And that can bite you too if you're not careful. Yeah.
Yeah. Somebody's been messing around with keyboard.
But I usually, when I turn the console on, I look at these to make sure they're where I remember them being and that they're unmuted. Because getting bitten twice is even worse than getting bitten once. Okay.
You want to mention the mutes at the...
Yes, we do have some stuff on here that is mute buttons. Up here we have basically three buttons right here that are like master mute controls, and they're really handy if you don't want to go through here like a crazy typewriter guy and push all those mute buttons. You can press band and vocal mute, and that mutes everything you see.
Oh.
And you can see the little mute light underneath the mute button.
Yeah, when you've got two mute buttons, you've got the channel mute right there, which I have decided I wanted to mute Rafe. But you also could mute the vocals from another place and it would show you that they are muted. So that's the giveaway that something fishy is going on over here in the DCA Denmark. So we've got band and vocal mutes, which is really nice. When they're done with their tune and the minister is heading towards the communion table, I usually let the last notes trail off and mute them. And then immediately go over here and get my minister ready to go, or he or she ready to go for the opening remarks or sermon or wherever we may be inside of the worship service. You also have a piano only button there that mutes everything having to do with everything but the piano, and also a little bit of keyboard one. Landon often likes to play a little bit behind Lisa, softly during maybe an offertory preamble or something of that effect. That's pretty handy. You also have a reverb mute here, which is really nice. Usually the minister will come in, they will say good morning, maybe a bit of announcements and general conversation. And then the musicians will shift over to their portion of the show. And Lisa usually, she's pretty consistent, likes to introduce the song, say good morning herself, and things of that nature. Now, Lisa sounds awesome when she's singing with reverb. She does not sound awesome when she is talking with reverb. So we've got a reverb mute button right there. And you won't see anything happen on this surface of the console. But that will stop that echo that sounds so lovely during their singing from happening during their speaking portions. That one I use all the time.
Okay.
All right, so I'd love to say we've got a purpose for all these buttons here, but we don't, which will probably make this session much, much shorter as a result. Okay. So, pretty simple. You switch over after your band portion is taken care of. You've got all of your ministerial mics, video. The mandolin is also stashed over here on the second layer. The mandolin makes a reasonably periodic appearance, but it's not so much to be on the first layer with the rest of the band. All right.
You may want to show how there's layers on both sides.
Yes.
That confused me at first.
Yes. The fellows that designed this console, the group that designed it, are brilliant, to say the least. And they have so much capability in it, and they have made it easy for us to get around on. So just like we have multiple layers over here, where all sorts of things are hidden and stashed away for use, we have the same thing going on over here. This is bank one, layer A, B, C, D, E, F. We also have bank two, same story, all the way from A to F. Usually A is where I keep it until I need to go someplace else. This is where you'll find the little intricate things. You have effects returns, you have a 70 volt send, which pipes this signal throughout Fogartie, the Family Life Center in general. This is also where the subwoofer volume is located. You've got a few auxiliaries here that really aren't used at this time.
They get used sometimes for special events, not on Sundays.
Gotcha.
They break on a floor monitor so that no one's sticking in ears from someone else in their ears.
Yes, that would be a hard sell, I would think. There again, you got more returns, a few more auxiliaries on C. Then you drift into matrix stuff, which we really don't need to talk terribly much about. Then you have another version of all of our ministerial mics. Tom through wireless 8. We'll probably change Tom before too very long to Lewis, and then on to something else as we progress through the year, hopefully. All right, so that's going on there. All right. I'm tempted to start talking about individual channels and the things that happen on this magical screen when you select them, but I'm also afraid. Do you want to go down that road, guys, or do we want to leave it in hands previous that have set those items up for you?
Yeah, leave it in the hands previous. Sounds good to me.
I was going to suggest the same right. thing.
One thing that may be helpful is just showing them how to rename a channel.
Perfect. That's we'll pick on Holly because that's a lovely person that shouldn't be picked on. So there we go. I'm on the second layer. We're looking at ministerial mics. We have Holly set up here. So I will select her. This screen changes. Her EQ is different from Joanne's and way different from Leslie's, as you can see, because voices are different. So there we are. So there's Holly. All right, so what if it's not Holly doing that? Let's...
somebody else is doing it. Yeah.
Let's make it Ansley, just to say that we did. All right, so on the screen, this is a touch screen, by the way. You would go up into this upper left corner where it says Holly, and it gives you a channel identifier, in this case, IP17, and you can press that. Now you are in a spot where you can change the name and the color of the channel if you choose to do so, or if it makes it easier for you. So we'll just put in Ansley here. And let's change her to, why not cyan? That's the color of the day. I've been running into it all over the place. So you hit apply, and now Holly, on the identifier above her channel, which is still selected, has become Ansley. And if we wanted to change her to yellow, we could do that. Red, if we're angry that day. Green, if we're not. So pretty much it'll follow your commands. It does require you to hit apply if you change the name of the channel. You can change the color all day long if you wish.
Okay.
But if you change the name, you will have to hit apply. So to get out of that screen, you simply hit close and you're back to the channel, now named Ansley, with a lovely pinkish hue going on there. Magenta, I guess. All right. Let's see, anything else? Any other suggestions, Craig? Pardon?
But she would have the same mix as, okay, so nothing changed in her mix.
You've just changed the name.
You're just changing the name, okay. Yeah.
And it is so very comforting to see the names of the people participating on the console, rather than like having to keep up with Mike 6 is Ansley. All that's gone now. It's right there in front of you. Of course, you know, if you don't know how to change that name, it really gets confusing because now you're looking at Ansley and you have to think Holly and so on and so forth. Okay.
So that's why the bulletin is so important for you then.
Yes, ma'am. Absolutely. I live by that thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mark it up pretty profusely as well. All right.
Yeah, far be it. They change anything at the last minute, right?
I know.
And it does. It happens.
Oh, yeah.
It does.
Or in process.
Yes.
You know, or in process, exactly.
During this time of focusing a lot more on the live stream, since that's where everybody has been for a while, and we've gotten a little more detailed in our bulletins. There's notes that actually the AV team or the worship leaders in the AV team have their own bulletin that has some additional notes and so forth in it. And it's gotten down to, okay, so-and-so is going to be standing here, so-and-so is going to be standing here, which is really great if we ministers actually do that.
Yeah.
So take that with a grain of salt. If you're running cameras, you know, get a tight shot on that one, but get a wide shot that you can also go to if you need to.
Yeah.
Usually the people are right, the places aren't always right.
Are you going to keep that when we go back to if there is any normal again?
Yeah, the AV bulletins and the worship leader bulletins, I imagine, will still have the same level of detail that they have now.
I hope so.
Yeah, me too. I'd love to see that on other bulletins also for other types of services, but
yeah.
Well, I think we're paying a little bit more attention to that. That wouldn't surprise me. Particularly if Montana is doing the bulletin, I imagine for Christmas Eve services, whatnot, whatever those end up looking like. I imagine we'll still see those kind of directions in the bulletin. We may not see it in things like funeral bulletins or something like that. Those are much simpler bulletins, usually much simpler services.
Yeah, you can say that.
Well, in the sanctuary, the pulpit mic can sometimes be a challenge. If it's pointed the wrong direction or someone decides they want to stand 6 feet behind it.
Yes.
There are different kind of challenges that are not as much in the technical field of running the console as just what's happening up front.
Oh, and I almost forgot. It's standard practice always in this industry that if anything goes wrong with the audio and you have a video operator close by, simply point at the video operator and keep your head down.
Oh, okay.
That's
Thanks
terrible.
A lot.
Don't do that. It's
Thanks.
Awful.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Sorry.
So, I guess I never knew, but maybe I missed this, but how do you turn this thing on and then how do you turn it off at the end of the service?
No problem. They've made that easy, thankfully. I had that same question the first time I saw this console because I couldn't find the on switch to save my life. Fortunately, they put it up front and center. You can press any channel and see that channel, but if you press that button again, you go back to this screen, and there actually is a touch button right there, power down.
Oh, it power up.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's also, I don't know if you can see it on this, there's a home button right there beside the screen that will always take you to that as well.
That's what I was going to say.
That's correct, right here.
You do need to shut down the console before killing the power there.
Yes. How this thing works, just a super brief explanation of why that's important, what he just said. This is a controller for a brain that lives in a room off to the side. It's a patching or rack unit. This is just the control surface. So when we go over here to home and we power this down, we're turning this off, but we're also turning that off. And if it powers down in that manner, you won't lose any information. It will retain the scenes and everything that was there. It's pretty robust. It's going to do that anyhow, but this is just good practice.
Okay.
Yeah.
And then reverse that and use that same button to power it back up?
Actually, it's a little bit different to power it up.
Okay.
The first thing that you need to do is go over to the wall behind Craig and the audio system on. It's actually a small decorum outlet cover there with lit buttons. And once you do that, there's a power strip located just underneath the surface that this mixer is sitting on.
Yeah, just like a Pro Presenter has one.
Exactly the same. Yeah. It actually in exactly the same position as well. Yeah. So a flip of that on, once the system is turned on the wall and you power the console, they'll start talking with one another. You'll see that conversation a little bit on the home screen itself as they link, and shortly thereafter, you'll be ready to run.
Okay, gotcha.
Session 8 of this series, I forget exactly what it was called, but something like controls.
Mm-hmm.
I remember the little mixers are in there because we've got some, like Todd said, this is just remote control for the actual brains of it. We have smaller, simpler remote controls that can be used for smaller events.
And it's the same remote control that the musicians use to change what they hear and how loudly they hear it in their earphones.
Okay.
And that is worth mentioning, that the musicians are not hearing what everyone else is hearing.
That is true. And just a secret dose of knowledge, they never have. Musicians will never, ever hear exactly what the audience is hearing. It's
right.
Just
oh, yeah.
Completely crazy environment. Although in this room, it's much more controlled than some places that I've been in, believe me. Okay.
But the last session is actually really designed for anyone to be able to kind of run things by themselves. So we'll go through how to turn everything on and off, how to use those little mixers in tandem with the video equipment and whatnot. Mm-hmm. A little bit on how to control lighting, just because I only know a little bit. But so that'll all be covered in a few weeks to kind of get you from start to finish. Especially if you're a one woman or one man show for smaller events, that happens a lot for funerals, for Wednesday programs, whatnot. We've tried to design this system so that it can scale up from one person to four people or so. And you wouldn't want to do everything as one person, but you can do a lot of it with one person if it's a simpler program. Hmm. Once you throw a Pro Presenter in there, it's a whole other ball game.
I was gonna say.
You're not gonna run Pro Presenter in something else, but
no, usually not.
But you can run. You can run cameras and audio if audio isn't too hairy.
Yeah. All right. Any questions you guys have? Anything bugging you? Okay. That's pretty much the general gist of just starting it up, using the preset, using the scenes, and riding herd over some faders. Well, that's easy to say and hard to do. But, you know, of course, if you run across any questions or anything that you didn't think of now but are important later, feel free to get my number from Craig. Give me a call. It's no big deal. I don't want this to become like the violin makers of old, where the craft is protected at all costs and I won't tell you anything. I want this to become widespread. I want more people to do this. This is a really neat way to participate in worship service and just church life in general. I feel like I'm needed and I'm very appreciative of that.
We are too. Believe me.
They are.
and because of that scene memory,
mm-hmm.
Even if you totally mess things up, as long as you don't overwrite,
yes.
that's another thing. Stay away from that store button on the
on the scene.
Just use the run button.
Yeah.
But we can recover stuff pretty easily if things go awry. And in fact, the band is used to, when they come in to rehearse, they come in and just out of principle, load, they need to know which scene to load now, but load a scene load the appropriate scene so that anything that we do on Wednesday or in between gets wiped out and it's back where it should be.
Exactly. But, very forgiving console. Very forgiving. Always a way out. Almost always a way out. Okay.
All right. Sounds good.
Awesome. Well, maybe we can, if you've got more questions, we might get together and do this again. Who knows?
And for anyone that wants to actually run this, you know, we're not going to put you in a worship service just after watching this video. We're going to get you in there and actually let you get your hands on the controls.
Absolutely.
Usually, AV training is very hands-on and reaching around people and not very conducive to the time we live in right now.
No.
So we're starting with video, and then hopefully this will give you enough that you can sit at the controls and someone else can stand at a distance and say, move up that fader over there. And
yeah.
And you'll know what we're talking about.
All right. Excellent.
Well, thank you, Todd, for doing this tonight.
My pleasure.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
It's nice to see you guys. Hopefully I'll see you in person soon.
Yeah, it would be nice.
Yes, indeed.
Take care.
All right. Bye. See you guys.
Go ahead and power down.